with sanctions raining down on Russia, how will this affect world trade and market sentiment? For discussion on that and more, we have Chris Nelson, the Executive Director of the British Chamber of Commerce of the Philippines. Chris, good morning.
Good morning to you and your viewers.
All right. So I guess let's start with that. What does the Ukraine crisis mean for investors? I mean, in Europe, it's not just triggering a security crisis, but it could mean added pain in the energy space. I mean, Russia is one of the world's largest producer of oil and gas.
Yeah, correct. I mean, already it's so even prior to obviously the armed assault or the invasion that's going on now, oil prices and gas prices in particular were already having an impact. And energy bills in the UK were already going up to extremely high levels. In fact, the government was trying to take some means to try and mitigate that. And obviously, you're going to see that also with fuel prices here and in other countries. I think in terms of the sanctions, obviously, they're trying to do different levels of sanctions. And of course, the question is going to be, will they move to the one which has been muted, which of course is the SWIFT? As you know, much of trade is through the SWIFT. That so far is not one of the sanctions, which is maybe why some of the analysts would say the market showed in the US a recovery yesterday because it hasn't moved to that level. So clearly we're in a very volatile stage. Deeper sympathy, of course, to all the poor people, civilians, everybody caught up in it. But obviously, the key, also the impact in countries such as the UK, is already energy prices, which already were on the up prior to this, obviously, further increase in the tensions. And you can only assume it's going to lead to, obviously, inflationary pressures.
Mm-hmm. And of course, inflationary pressures could lead to more hawkish central banks, yet another reason to start hiking rates there. But once again, you know, this crisis, Chris, is causing companies to rethink their geographies and supply chains. For one, a Japanese steel giant is now looking for alternatives to Russia and Ukraine for iron ore. Do you think that countries in Asia may stand to benefit from the migration of some global operations out of Ukraine or Russia and into the region, perhaps?
Honestly, I think that's too early to say. I think more logically is the fact that there's already been a looking towards Asia. If you look at what we've been trying to do, obviously, we've been promoting the Philippines consistently over many years. If you take, obviously, the UK, obviously, the key event for us was Brexit, leaving the European Union, but not Europe, as obviously the government clearly emphasized, and clearly here working together with these sanctions. And in that respect, the UK government has focused on Asia and is very active in Asia, and I think is very keen to see what it can do. And I would just highlight the fact that last week was the economic dialogue third between 2 weeks ago, I beg your pardon, 9th of February, between the UK and the Philippines, between our ambassador and obviously the Department of Trade and Investment. And then, of course, we also had a visit from our trade envoy, the MP Richard Graham, who's come on a number of occasions. So I think I would say this. I think it's too early to say for the crisis in Ukraine and Russia, but I do think UK interest in Asia is very high, and I think that will continue to be the case.
I'm very curious, Chris, do you have a counterpart, a British Chamber of Commerce in Russia or in Ukraine? Have you talked to your peers there?
Well, there is actually. So first of all, there is a British Chamber of Commerce, which is like a holding or they're actually based in London. And we've all joined them as what we call international members. There will be a Russian, may not be named the same way, because obviously chambers of commerce are set up differently in different countries, but there will be representatives. And I'm sure it's causing, because obviously the impact of this is going to be felt in Europe, in obviously places where we do clearly have chambers like Germany and so forth. As you know, Germany has suspended the gas to pipeline project.
So
that is definitely going to go on. And I think, obviously, the impact in Europe is obviously going to be far higher. For Asia, I think, obviously, one of the key concerns has got to be, obviously, fuel prices and whether that will then relate, obviously, into obviously the price that motorists, and more importantly for logistics. But I think if I bring it to your other point on trade and investment, I think the focus on the Philippines and Asia is there anyhow, and continues to grow.
All right. Let's shift gears now and go to the COVID topic. It's been a big week for the UK in terms of the fight against COVID. This week, people in England who test positive will no longer be legally required to isolate and wear masks. All remaining restrictions have been replaced by government's living with COVID plan, despite cases in the UK still elevated. Last I checked 2 days ago, it was at 39,000 daily new cases. How is the global reopening looking for the business sector? And do you think here in Manila, we're ready to go back to the most loose quarantine restriction of alert level one?
Yeah, so let me take the questions in order. So first of all, the UK has been very successful. It's the vaccinations. And if you look, of course, while the cases have been high, the hospitalization rate has been significantly lower. And mm-hmm. I think that in not just the UK, but I think in Europe in general, there is now a move towards seeing obviously COVID into the endemic stage as opposed to being a pandemic stage and living with it. I mean, we have to accept that we'll be there. And if I come now to the Philippines, it's very good to see that you've got obviously lowest levels for a long time. And I think this is testimony to the vaccination rate. It's the boosters. And, of course, all the work that's gone on both private and public. So, yes, I think Metro Manila is ready for Alert 1, which that starts as of 1st of March. And I think what's important is to look at how we're going to keep that businesses open and moving forward. And, of course, supporting it with the measures, as obviously, which we've discussed, to keep the growth rates, because obviously all the economies had a major decrease and, of course, have had a rebound, but now we want to be beyond the rebound. So, yes, very good news. And I think Metro Manila definitely will welcome and will businesses will see, obviously, Alert 1 and the benefits thereof. Okay.
And speaking of measures, let's talk about a legislative measure that you guys successfully pushed. The Retail Trade Act, you've been a big proponent of the act, amending this, which the president signed in December, I think, of last year, essentially lowering the barriers to entry for foreign retailers, like in capital, from $2.5 million to just $500,000. How much new British business do you see coming into the Philippines as a result of this? Are there names already being floated?
Well, I can't float you names as much as I would on a holiday, but I will... I'll give you this. So first of all, we have an event on Monday, actually. We're going to have video. We get a recorded message, obviously, from Secretary Lopez. We have Neda, and we have somebody who's already selling here. I would also like to say we just had an event also last week ago where we highlighted successful exporters into the retail sector, both of a food, beverage, and obviously snacks. And our plan is to roll this out and to highlight through our wide organizations that we have in the UK. But I just want to also make a quick point that the Retail Trade Act, which, as you rightly said, we were one of the main advocates, along also with the Foreign Investment Act and the Public Service Act. Both those two, we're very hopeful. One has already gone, the Foreign Investment Act, for the signature of the president. The Public Service Act has already passed the bicameral, and obviously we're now hoping the next stage is the enrolled bill. And before I forget, the other thing which I think we've talked about and I think is very key for the Philippines is also joining RCEP, the Regional Comprehensive Trade. And the reason I say this is that this is the time to support economic growth, opening up the economy with these liberalizations. And I think with RCEP, that will be key for them to show to investors, to trading partners, the Philippines is obviously a key member of that very large and exciting trading group.
Mm-hmm. The message clearly is very good, because the Philippines, based on the OECD FDI Restrictiveness Index in terms of ranking, the Philippines has the third most restrictive FDI rules out of 83 countries included in the OECD study. So that's one. But on the other end, you've got the smaller local players and local companies here worried if we let all of the foreign companies in, they might not be able to compete. What do you say to that?
Well, I think a couple of things. First of all, I think they can compete. And secondly, actually, capital and supporting those smaller players will actually come from a more open environment. I mean, foreign direct investment can go into other areas. So I think there is a way forward here. I think the Philippines has a lot of talent. It has the opportunity to benefit from this enhanced trading sector. I think that the bills passed, and I'd like to commend, obviously, the effort that's been gone on, and hopefully we'll get all those bills over the line. They will be a significant boost. And when Congress resumes, which I believe is the 23rd of May, that gives them the opportunity, obviously, in the Senate to ratify RCEP. So if you combine all that, I think actually the smaller players will be beneficiaries.
All right. And on that note, thank you very much, Chris, for the insights and the time. I know it's early morning there where you're joining us from. Thank you always for being with ANC. We'll talk to you soon next month.
Talk to you next month and wish everybody a very happy and long weekend. So enjoy the holiday.
All right. Thank you, Chris. Do keep safe. We'll talk to you soon.
Bye-bye. Thank you very much. Take care.
All right. Take care. Now-